committee will please come to order. The we have a number of bills before us this morning, and do you want to give me? I'll hold back. First, a bill the chair calls up is S550, introduced by Senator Akaka, seeks to ensure that the District of Columbia court system has a number of judges it needs to work efficiently and effectively. Without objection, the bill will be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. Congress has established an overall limit of 58 on the number of judges that may be seated on the D.C. Superior Court. In addition to a chief judge of that 58, 15 are family court judges. This bill increases the total cap from 58 to 61. And I have a further statement in the record. Now non-family court judges are retiring. They can't be replaced because of the cap of 58. The inability to replace the retiring judges has contributed to delays in the judicial proceedings and increased case backlogs. I think this is a reasonable proposal. It's needed, and I ask my colleagues to join me in supporting S550. Mr. Davis, any
comments? Mr. Chairman, I support this legislation. Would have supported this several years ago, but our majority leader at the time felt this cap was important and we couldn't move it, so I'm happy to join with Senator Koch and you in supporting this.
Anybody else wish to be recognized on this bill? If not,
Chairman.
Yes,
Mr. Gibbs. We had a hearing on it in the subcommittee on Tuesday, and we certainly concur with your position and that of the ranking member, Mr. Davis, and would urge passage.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to say this is a no-cost bill. It's passed the Senate, so I thank you for moving this bill. Thank you.
We ready to proceed to the vote. The vote will now occur on reporting S550 out of the committee. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion is agreed to. The next bill is HR 5551. Regarding compensation of attorneys representing indigent defendants in the district. Without objection, the bill will be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. In December, Congress passed fiscal year 2008 Omnibus Appropriations Act that allocated an increase in compensation provided for attorneys representing indigent defendants in the D.C. courts. This bill, introduced by Representative Danny Davis, simply provides the appropriate authorization so that compensation can be paid. It would increase the hourly pay rate from $65 to $80 for D.C. CJA attorneys representing indigent defendants. I have a further statement I'd like to just put in the record without objection. Mr. Davis?
Mr. Chairman, I support this legislation. As you note, it does raise the hourly rate from $65 to $80 for attorneys representing indigent defendants. This brings the attorneys a step closer in terms of pay parity to those attorneys representing indigent defendants in the federal courts located in the district. My understanding is that Congress appropriated the funds for the pay raise in the FY08 appropriation for the district, but this legislation changes the authorizing law to allow the money now to be spent, and I would urge my colleagues to support it.
Mr. Davis, I want to recognize
you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The subcommittee also had a hearing on this bill on Tuesday. It has the support of the District of Columbia Courts, the D.C. Superior Court, Trial Lawyers Association, and of course the funds have already been appropriated, and it's no additional cost, and we would urge passage of this bill.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for bringing this bill forward. This is only regular order since the funds are in the bill, and I appreciate that we're authorizing the bill as required. Thank you.
Are there any amendments to this legislation? If not, we'll proceed to a vote to report out H.R. 5551. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion's agreed to. I'd like to skip over H.R. 4106 temporarily and go to H.R. 2780. This bill I call the bill up and ask that it be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. This bill clarifies the method for computing certain annuities based on a part-time service in the federal government. This bill, introduced by Representative Moran last June and is supported by the administration, it would correct the situation which now exists for certain long-serving federal employees who wish to serve on a part-time basis at the end of their careers, but who face an illogical reduction in their annuities if they do so. This is a technical correction to the retirement rules, which will allow the federal government to fully utilize the services of some of our most experienced workers, and I urge members to support it. I do want to mention that we understand this bill will score. However, we'll be looking for an offset as this bill moves to the floor. Mr. Davis?
Mr. Chairman, I know it scores, but let me just say the reality is if we don't bring part-time people back into government, we end up contracting this out, and that scores even more. Unfortunately, under these arcane scoring rules, that doesn't show. This actually not only saves the federal government money over the long term, but it allows people with expertise to come back and continue to be of service. Once again, I think the reality is many of these people would come back as contractors otherwise. This is a good bill. I'm glad to see us move it today. Thank you.
Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We actually had a hearing on this bill back in August and concluded that it's actually currently punitive in relationship to what happens to individuals who work part-time. And so we would certainly concur with your position and that of the ranking member, Mr. Davis, and urge passage of this bill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. Anyone else wish to be heard on the bill? The chair calls for any amendments to the legislation. Seeing none, the vote now comes on reporting H.R. 2780 from the committee. All those in favor of the motion will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion's agreed to. The next item of legislation will be H.R. 3033, the Contractors and Federal Spending Accountability Act. This bill was introduced by Representative Maloney. It would create a government-wide database of companies and grantees that have been disbarred or suspended by the federal government. No such comprehensive database currently exists, and creating one would allow more efficient monitoring of federal procurement. This is a common sense initiative that would allow the federal government to track fraudulent contractors and grantees and stop them from moving from agency to agency if they are disbarred. The bill is modeled on one that Representative Maloney passed for the City of New York when she was a City Council member. That bill has been very effective. I understand that the minorities raised a number of concerns with the bill that was originally drafted. We worked with Representative Davis and his staff to try to address these concerns. I believe the measure now enjoys bipartisan support, and I would urge members to support the bill. Let me call up the bill officially, ask unanimous consent that it be considered as read, and open to amendment at any point. And Mr. Davis, do you wish to?
Mr. Chairman, thanks. This legislation would require the GSA to establish a publicly accessible website database of all civil, criminal, and administrative proceedings concluded by the federal government and state governments against federal contractors or grant assistance recipients within the most recent five-year period. It would require that debarment proceedings be initiated against a contractor or grant recipient if a judgment or conviction for an offense constituting a cause for debarment was rendered against the company twice during a three-year period. Requires any individual seeking federal contract or grant or to disclose all federal or state suspension or debarments and related administrative agreements, all civil, criminal, administrative proceedings concluded against the firm, as well as default terminations within 5 years. The legislation has been improved since the initial version, which would have created a draconian enforcement measure establishing a blacklist that would defame and degrade firms merely accused of wrongdoing, not necessarily convicted, simply accused. The provision has been altered to include those civil, criminal, and administrative proceedings concluded as opposed to merely initiated. I appreciate the majority's willingness to make these changes, which I think improves the bill. It's hard to argue against the availability of much of this information to contracting officials. The problem remains that a good deal of information collected will likely be irrelevant to the required determination that a firm is a responsible prospective contractor. Further, I'm concerned about the publication of this information on the Internet. In the case of administrative proceedings relating to suspension and debarment, the proceeding is not concluded in the sense that there is no decision to debar. While the information would have a clear purpose for acquisition officials, I fail to see the value of placing this on a public website. The only purpose would be to punish or intimidate firms based on allegations. As a result of this widespread publication, companies could suffer harm to their reputation by reference to material that can be taken out of context. Also want to address this two strikes you're out provision, which mandates the initiation of debarment proceedings against firms convicted of offenses that may be a cause of debarment. I support the appropriate use of the debarment process to prevent bad actors from getting federal contracts. Those are put in not to be punitive to the contractors, but to protect the government against unscrupulous contractors. That has always been the purpose in federal contracting. But I don't see a need to limit the discretion of the government's debarment official in bringing these actions at the appropriate time. Again, this smacks of a punishment versus protecting the government, which is why the debarment was initially instituted. I don't think that this improves the acquisition system, and I don't see how this will improve our ability to get the best value goods and services we need at fair and reasonable prices. Further, I am concerned about when you say that these are concluded for debarment, what happens when you get an agreed-upon resolution without a conviction? For example, you get some kind of consent order saying, as they often do, we didn't do it, but we won't do it again. Does that count? And I'm not sure the way this is written that we understand if that counts or not. Should that count? And if you read this in an appropriate context, it could mean that firms like Boeing and Lockheed Martin could face debarment, because many times they have agreed upon instances where they'll move consent agreements along. There's not an actual conviction, but there is a conclusion to an allegation. So I'm not sure if this is ready for prime time, Mr. Chairman. I'm not going to insist on a roll call vote, but I just want to voice my concerns on this, and should this go to the floor, I will raise these issues again, and we will continue to look at them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. Anyone else, Mr. Davis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Of course, we've had extensive discussion in our subcommittee relative to this legislation. We think that teleworking is an idea whose time has come, and we seek to strengthen it by, one, trying to make sure that it's taken seriously, that we make use of it. It has tremendous impact if used appropriately. For example, it promotes a great deal of saving in terms of reducing pollution, in terms of preventing, in some instances, a great deal of gridlock. And it also makes it perhaps more efficient to operate in terms of, in some instances, costs that would be allocated to space. So we think it's a good bill. It's time to seriously implement it. I'm in support of the manager's amendment. I'm also in support of the changes that have been proposed, and we look forward to its passage.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Mr. Danny Davis, Mr. Tom Davis.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just have a couple of minutes. Let me explain to you how this could work. I'm going to take a company that's been in the news recently just because I heard the Democratic chairman today talk about a government contract that should be awarded to it, Boeing Company. Boeing was accused of
this chairman.
Not you, Mr. Chairman Waxman. The chairman, Mr. Dean. This is the Boeing case with Airbus that everybody's concerned about. Boeing was accused of illegal hiring of government officials and improper use of proprietary information, and they reached a settlement in May of 2006. That's within the three-year period contemplated under this act. Now, what happened is there was not a conviction. There was a settlement in the amount of $615,000, which Boeing and the U.S. Attorney's Office reached a tentative agreement in their investigations of a hiring of a former Air Force acquisition official, Darlene Druin, and the investigation by the U.S. Attorney for the Central District of California regarding possession of a competitor's information in connection with launch service contracts with the Air Force, and I could go on and on. This clearly, I think, was misconduct on the part of Boeing. There was not a formal conviction of the company, but a $615 million settlement, I think, speaks to the fact that there was probably some wrongdoing here. Under delivering military aircraft containing Russian titanium was another problem. This was a settlement date of September 2004. Again, we're talking within a three-year period. This would move Boeing to debarment proceedings under this law. The date of settlement there, that was a government contract fraud allegation against them. They only paid $7.4 million on that. Boeing and the U.S. government reached a settlement over the claims Boeing delivered military aircraft containing parts made of Russian melted titanium rather than a U.S. product in violation of the Berry Amendment under that. Under the case of Beck versus Boeing, again in 2004 in July, another settlement. This was a labor dispute, gender discrimination class action, where Boeing agreed to pay between $40 and $72 million and change its practices to settle a gender discrimination case. Again, under this legislation, as I read it, this would put them into debarment proceedings. And finally, machine tools and export violations from China. This goes back to 2001. They paid a $2 million fine. That was an administrative fine, but that was a final adjudication. And I could go on and on. In 2000, a defective China hook, Chinook helicopters, they paid a $54 million settlement. I'm not sure under this legislation if these large multi-million dollar settlements count as, quote, adjudications or, and if this would in fact mean that Boeing couldn't compete for U.S. contracts as debarment proceedings are initiated under that. And I'm not sure the author of this legislation could explain to me whether this would include Boeing or if Boeing would not be included under this. By the way, this applies to a number of other companies, large companies as well. I'm concerned that what this means is that instead of the government having a vast array of competitors on this, we are narrowing this artificially. We have, I think, debarment proceedings under the current law, which I think work pretty well, but they are to protect the government from defective pricing and defective performance, not to punish companies for wrongdoings that they or their subsidiaries may have done. And that is why I oppose this legislation at this point. Again, I'm not going to ask for a roll call. I will allow a voice and allow this to move to the floor, but I continue to have reservations about this.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. If there are no other opening statements, the chair has an amendment at the desk, and without objection, it will be considered as read. The amendment reflects the version of the bill as adopted by the Government Management Subcommittee on March 11th, with an additional technical clarification made to address a concern raised by Ranking Member Tom Davis. The amendment clarifies that the administrative agreements included in the suspension and debarment database are agreements entered into to conclude a suspension or debarment proceedings. There are no other changes to the bill as reported by the subcommittee, and I would ask members to support this bipartisan amendment. Any discussion about the amendment itself? If not, the vote now occurs on the amendment. All those in favor of the Waxman amendment say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendment's agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill? If not, we'll proceed to the vote to report out H.R. 3033 as amended. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
The ayes have it, and the motion is agreed to. The House is now going into session at 10:30, and on the House floor, there is going to be a moment of silence in honor and in memory of our troops who so bravely fought in Afghanistan and Iraq. And I don't know if we're exactly synchronized, but I think it's appropriate that we too join in that tribute. So I'd like to interrupt the proceedings of the committee's deliberation on legislation and ask everyone to please rise for a moment of silence. The chair now calls up H.R. 3928, and without objection will be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. This is a bill to require certain large government contractors that receive more than 80% of their annual gross revenue from federal contracts to disclose the names and salaries of their most highly compensated offices. H.R. 3928, introduced by Representative Murphy last October, will bring much-needed sunshine to a very dark corner of federal contracting. Under the bill, companies that are privately held and they receive the vast majority of their revenues from taxpayer dollars, would be required to disclose the salaries of their top officers. Salary information for publicly traded companies is already required to be made public under SEC rules, applying the same rules to companies that do the vast majority of their business with the federal government is a common sense step. American taxpayers have a right to know where their hard-earned dollars are going, and I would urge my colleagues to support this measure. Mr. Tom Davis.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, one question I have is, does this still apply to fixed-price contracts? Fixed-price contracts are done in a competitive environment where, in many cases, the best value is determined. And under those circumstances, I don't think it makes any difference how much anybody's getting paid. All we know is that from a contracting point of view, low bid is going to win or best value. And what people are paid along that way and how that functions really, I don't think, should be the business of the acquisition officer. But I would add, under current law, that information is available to any acquisition officer that wants it. This legislation requires any non-public company receiving more than $5 million from federal contracts and earning 80% of its revenue from federal contracts to disclose the names and salaries of the contractor's principal executive officer, principal financial officer, the three most highly compensated officers, as well as the firm's directors. This information could be useful under certain cost-type contracts, where the government reimburses a firm for its reasonable and allowable cost plus fee. I think under those kind of circumstances, there are already limitations on how much of a person's salary is reimbursable under federal acquisition regulations. Moreover, is this information also available? It is available to acquisition officials to the extent it's relevant now. I've asked for fixed price contracts, does it apply or not? And I don't know if the chairman or someone can let me know, but I assume it probably is. Now, it's clear that this bill serves one purpose, and that purpose is to go after Blackwater because the CEO of that privately held firm that performs under fixed price government contracts refuses to disclose his salary during a hearing on security contracting. It has no acquisition purpose per se that I can see. The system currently provides for the availability of this information to those who need it in the acquisition officers. What I think it's trying to do is to punish and embarrass privately held firms that have provoked the ire of the committee. This bill will accomplish, I don't think, anything than to discharge the participation of privately held firms. It discouraged the participation of privately held firms in the government market. So I'm going to vote no. Again, I will allow this to move forward on a voice vote, but I just want to express those concerns, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Mr. Murphy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank at the outset the chairman, both the full committee and the subcommittee, as well as Mr. Welsh and Mr. Duncan for their support and help on this bill. I think at the outset it's important to note that this bill really is going to affect a very limited number of contractors, and at the appropriate time I'll offer an amendment which comes at this suggestion of both OMB and in part through the Associated General Contractors Association to further limit the number of contractors we're talking about here. But when you're speaking of private contractors who are doing more than 80% of their business with the federal government, you are in essence almost talking about quasi-public agencies, organizations that would not exist if it wasn't for their government contracts. Now, already we have disclosure for the salaries of government employees. We have disclosure related to the salaries of public firms that do the bulk share of business with federal departments. It simply seems, as a matter of fairness with regard to contracting and disclosure, that we should know for those firms that are gaining 80, 90, or 100% of their revenue from the taxpayers' dollars as to how much they're taking in profit for salaries. Again, I think this is a very limited amendment. It may come out of hearings on this committee with regard to defense contracts, but I do think it will, in the future, to apply to many contractors out there in a variety of different forums who may be taking a little bit too much off of the cost of the contracts for CEO salary. With regard to fixed price contracts, I do think there is relevance with regard to fixed price contracts. I think in our assessment of whether we have gotten a fair price overall, I think relevant data in that analysis is for companies that are receiving 80% or more of their revenue from the federal government, the amount of money that their top executives are earning. If those salaries are way out of whack with regard to the amount of money that they are spending on the actual services. I do think that that is relevant data with regard to whether or not we got the fair price that we thought we did at the outset. I'd be happy to work on this bill, especially with regard to which contracts it covers as it moves forward. And again, I appreciate the chairman's help and other members of the committee's help, and I will be offering an amendment to further limit the applicability of the bill.
Are there any further opening statements on the legislation? Ms. Fox.
Mr. Chairman, I think that if we're going to do something like this to private contractors, we ought to think about doing the same thing for nonprofits. I think that there are many, many nonprofits out there who rely totally on government money, and I think it would be in the public interest to know what the salaries are of the top officials in those agencies. I don't know why we have more of a need to know that, because if they're taking a lot of money out for salaries, we should know that for nonprofits, and I'd like to offer an amendment to do that.
I thank the gentlelady for her comments, and if she'd yield to me, I think what you say makes a lot of sense, and if it's a nonprofit that's a contractor, under these circumstances, they ought to have their top executive salaries also disclosed.
It probably applies to
and I think it I think it does already, and if it doesn't, we'll make sure it does.
Well, if you could give me that indulgence, Mr. Chairman, I'd appreciate it, just so we're sure of that, because I think, again, you know from my conversations with you that my concern here is that we have accountability. Mm-hmm. I think accountability should apply across the board. And I think that if we don't do that, then we are not doing what the public expects us to do. And so whatever we can do to increase accountability with any dollar that's spent by the federal government, we should do that.
Thank you very much. Mr. Murphy, well, I'll now call for amendments. I know Mr. Murphy has an amendment, so I want to recognize him to offer it. And without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman is recognized to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The amendment before us is fairly simple. It raises the threshold for covered contractors under the Act from $5 million to $25 million. This comes both at the suggestion of Mr. Dennett, who testified before the committee when we heard this bill, and also partially at the suggestion of contractors' organizations. This mirrors requirements and thresholds within federal regulations, and it would further limit the applicability of this Act to the organizations that we want to be going after.
Gentlemen, would permit to yield to me. I think it's a seems like a legitimate attempt to address the concerns of small businesses, and I would urge the adoption of this amendment. Any further discussion on the amendment offered by
Mr. Chairman, I think this is more palatable, number one. Number two, the only other thing I think, if we're going to go this direction, and I'm not sure it's a direction that adds anything to the acquisition process, except you could add some sunshine for people who can make out of it what they will, is we probably ought to go the next step and apply this to grant and grantees. That would be earmarks and everything else that come down the way, and I'd be happy to work with the gentleman as this goes to the floor to make this more palatable, to make this across the board, so that we would have that information. Since no action is taken on this information per se, but it would just be available. As I said, a lot of this is already available to acquisition officers should they feel they need it in negotiating, for example, a sole price of, a sole source fixed price contract or the like. But in this, we apply this to grantors and grantees. If we're going to go this direction, we probably ought to go whole hog. And if a gentleman will work with us as this moves to the floor, maybe this is the direction the Congress wants to go. Let's make it for everybody.
Any further discussion of the Murphy Amendment? Mr. Sarbanes.
On the nonprofit question, it may be that the Form 990s that nonprofits are required to file may already include information on executive compensation. I'm not sure about that, but that could be something that could be.
Well, I think we should check on that. The gentleman thought that the 499s, is that the form that's filed by the nonprofit? 990s would have that information.
Well, this, I think,
goes a little further, includes some more people in it than would look at.
Ms. Fox?
I don't know the answer to this question, honestly. I'm hoping somebody here will. Is there any one place where that information is available in the federal government so that all grants, for example, I know we've had problems with getting earmarks published, but is there one place where somebody, any citizen could go and find out the amount of grant money going to an agency, or do they have to go look up every 990? Is that what it is, Mr. Sarbanes? 990? Do they, for nonprofits, but would they have to go to the IRS?
No, generally, yield to me. A bill that was passed last year, the Obama-Coburn bill, which was supported by this committee as well, did provide that there must be a website of how extensive, of all grants by the government.
But it does not have salaries.
No.
And I said, I think Mr. Murphy, I'll just ask him, I mean, are we happy to work on grants as this moves to the floor? If we do that, I don't know that it adds anything to acquisition, but in terms of sunshine, I think we'd be willing to support it if we apply across the board.
If the gentleman would yield, I think the answer is absolutely. I think that sunshine should be as broad as possible. I would imagine at just first reading of this bill that it might not foreclose the possibility of nonprofit organizations being subject to the requirements of it, but I'm happy to work with Ms. Fox and with the ranking members. This bill moves towards the floor to make this as broad as possible.
I'd like to express my willingness to continue to look at this and work it through, but the bill does apply to contractors who receive more than 80% of their annual gross revenue from federal contracts. So I would want to be sure that we're not doing something inadvertently that will have consequences that we may regret. So let's all look at it to work on it together. The vote now occurs on the Murphy Amendment. All those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment's agreed to. Are there any further amendments to H.R. 3928? If not, the vote comes on the reporting H.R. 3928 from the
Chairman,
committee.
Let me just say, given the assurances of yourself and Mr. Murphy to work with Ms. Fox and myself to make this a really sunshine bill, I will support the bill.
All those in favor of reporting the bill will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion is agreed to. The next item of business is H.R. 4881. The Contracting and Tax Accountability Act. Chair calls up that bill and asks that it be considered as read. This bill was introduced by Representative Ellsworth. It would prohibit the award of federal contracts to companies with seriously delinquent tax debts. It accomplishes this by requiring contractors to certify that they do not have a seriously delinquent debt and by authorizing the Treasury Department to disclose such information to contracting agencies. This issue has been raised many times over the past few years, and resolving it has been complicated by jurisdictional concerns arising in other committees. In crafting this bill, Representative Towns has attempted to take those concerns into consideration, and I commend him for the hard work he has put into this issue. The minority has also raised some concerns regarding previous versions of this legislation. And I want to thank Ranking Member Tom Davis for working constructively with us to address those issues. The end product before us today is solid legislation, which should have bipartisan support, and which I hope will address this issue once and for all. And I urge members to support H.R. 4881. Mr. Davis?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, once again, let me just add, you have an acquisition point of view, you have tax collection, you have a lot of competing public policy goals with this. If the company that can provide the best service, whether it's technical, whether it's making bulletproof vests, whether it, if they have a tax lien and they provide the best service to the government, I don't think they should be debarred. That hurts the government. But look, we've worked on some amendments to this. This basically codifies what is existing federal policy in some areas. And I think what we want at the end of the day is for the federal government to be able to get the best value for the tax dollars. We owe that to taxpayers. And if somebody is owes the government money, and they get it out, and we can make them work it off through a contract, I don't think that there is necessarily a problem with that. But I think these have been addressed in the amendments, and I am going to support the legislation.
Any further opening statements on the legislation? If not, are there any amendments to the bill? Seeing none, the motion now comes on reporting H.R. 4881, the Contracting and Tax Accountability Act of 2008, from the committee. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the bill, the motion has been agreed to. The next item is H.R. 4106, the Telework Improvements Act of 2008. Without objection, this bill will be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. The bill we're now considering, H.R. 4106, the Telework Improvements Act of 2008, requires federal agencies to develop telework policies to allow more employees to participate in telework. And I appreciate Chairman Danny Davis's leadership on telework through his work on this, leadership on telework through his work on the Federal Workforce Subcommittee and in introducing this bill. I would also like to recognize the efforts of Mr. Sarbanes, who has been a champion on this issue and who made an effort to include language similar to H.R. 4106 as part of the energy bill Congress passed last year. Ranking Member Tom Davis also has been an advocate for federal telework programs for many years. Telework plays an important role in reducing energy consumption, air pollution, and traffic congestion. Telework also has a number of benefits beyond energy savings, including cost savings for agencies and better scheduling flexibility for employees. Greater use of telework can also allow the federal government to function in the event of an emergency, whether it is a natural disaster or a terrorist attack. Yet despite these benefits, some agencies continue to underutilize telework. According to the most recent survey by the Office of Personnel Management, only 6% of federal employees were teleworking in 2006. That is with OPM counting employees who only teleworked once per month. At the appropriate time, I'll offer an amendment that will make a number of changes to the bill, many of which address concerns raised by Ranking Member Tom Davis. H.R. 4106 will provide needed improvements to federal telework, and I urge its passage. I want to recognize Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, let me give my very deep thanks to my colleague from Chicago, Mr. Davis, and to Mr. Sarbanes for continuing to take up this issue. The federal government is far behind the private sector in terms of telework. And when you take a look at the mass traffic congestion we have in the region, take a look at quality of life issues and just efficiencies, we ought to be more proactive at the federal level than we are. And despite efforts of this committee and Congress, the federal government does not seem to get it. And this legislation, I think, moves along in terms of mandates and in terms of strong suggestions to the bureaucracy, things they need to do to make this a reality. The Telework Improvement Act requires federal agencies to put in place telework policies to utilize telework as much as possible. I ask my entire statement to be put in the record. I appreciate the changes that the majority is willing to make at our suggestion. We're actually trying to write a very serious bill here that I think will have some ramifications in the future on governmental efficiency and work satisfaction and traffic congestion. So I appreciate the work of the gentleman involved with this and urge its support.
Without objection, the gentleman's full statement will be made part of the record. Mr. Sarbanes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm excited about this legislation because I think it's really going to make, first and foremost, it's going to make the federal government more competitive with the private sector in terms of tapping into a lot of talent that's out there and is responding to the telework opportunity, just as in the past there's been a response to flexibility in the workplace with respect to part-time and other kinds of benefits that are available. This bill will do a number of things. First, it will require that a telework policy is established in each of the agencies. Secondly, it will require the appointment of a telework managing officer so that somebody actually has ownership within each agency to make sure that the policy is articulated in a way that people can access it and really benefit from it. Third, it provides for certain evaluations by the GAO as things move along to determine whether the telework opportunity is being pursued in the ways that it should. We received some very stimulating testimony in the hearings that were conducted at the subcommittee level on this, and I want to thank Chairman Davis for his leadership on this bill and for assembling those witnesses, both private sector witnesses and witnesses from the public sector. In the private sector, they've already absorbed this as being a critical part of their competitive infrastructure, and they've moved past concerns that you hear expressed sometimes about accountability and productivity, and have realized that frankly the productivity of their workforce is going up when they offer this telework opportunity. We also heard from agencies in the federal government, U.S. Patent and Trademark Office being an example of this, where they've really embraced telework in ways that have increased the productivity of those agencies. So I think it's going to put the federal government back on the cutting edge with respect to workforce competitiveness. And for that reason, obviously I'm excited that we've taken it up today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Welch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I support this legislation, but I have in mind one of the concerns that we have, and I know this bill is going to address, is to make certain that teleworking is secure. I'm recalling our hearing in July of 07 when we heard evidence about some of the information that inadvertently was shared through peer-to-peer services such as LimeWire. Indeed, prior to that hearing, the committee staff, as you recall, ran a series of common searches during a one-month period and reported they found personal bank records and tax forms, attorney-client communications, corporate strategy documents for Fortune 500 companies, confidential accounting, corporate accounting documents, government emergency response plans, and even some military operation owners. And obviously, there's no legitimate reason for a government computer to contain an open peer-to-peer service such as LimeWire. And it'll be monitoring the implementation, we will be monitoring the implementation of this legislation to ensure that every step is taken to make certain that such software is not on computers that are being used by government employees to telework. I mean, that obviously is not the goal of this. The goal is what Mr. Sarbanes and Mr. Davis have so well articulated. So we want to get the benefits of this legislation, but ensure that we do confront foreseeable and unforeseeable risk to privacy and government information. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well,
gentlemen, yield for a
yes.
Second. Those are fair concerns. I know in the original language of the bill, there are provisions to account for security concerns. And also know, Mr. Chairman, I think that your amendment is going to further strengthen the language with respect to some of those security issues.
The chair has an amendment at the desk, and without objection, it'll be considered as read. But before I even consider the amendment, I would like to ask unanimous consent that Representative Danny Davis' statement as the chairman of the subcommittee be entered in the record, and without objection, that'll be the order. My amendment attempts to address concerns and suggestions raised by Ranking Member Tom Davis. Although I understand it does not address all of his suggestions, I believe this amendment improves the bill. Among its provisions, the amendment codifies telework in Title V, requires that essential personnel be equipped to telework during a catastrophe, and adds telework as an issue to be coordinated by the Chief Human Capital Officers Council. In addition, the amendment strengthens the information security protections of the original bill. While we want this bill to send a clear message that Congress supports teleworking, we do not want to compromise federal government information in any way. I want to thank Representatives Danny Davis and Tom Davis, as well as Mr. Sarbanes, for working on this amendment, and I urge its passage. Is there any further discussion on this amendment?
Thank you for including our concerns, Mr. Chairman.
Without the vote now occurs on the Waxman Amendment to H.R. 4106. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendments agreed to. Further amendments to the legislation, Mr. Davis?
You've included ours in your amendment.
I don't think so.
Do we have one? Okay, then I call up an amendment.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read.
Thank you. In large federal agencies, we already have chief human capital officers that will fulfill this role. In some small agencies, mandating the creation of a career GS-15 position dedicated solely to telework probably doesn't make sense. This was also raised by Mr. Marchant in the subcommittee. Therefore, our amendment just allows that rather than mandates agencies to appoint telework managing officers if they determine it makes sense. But if an agency decides not to create the new career GS-15 position responsible for telework policy, the agency would still be required to assign the telework responsibilities to either the chief human capital officer or a career employee within the agency. I think it's a reasonable amendment at this point to get the ball rolling and to give this the appropriate priorities within the agency, and I would urge its adoption.
Any further discussion of this amendment? It's been agreed upon by the Democratic and Republican staffs. All those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendments agreed to. Any further amendments to the legislation? If not, the motion before us is to report out H.R. 4106, the Telework Improvements Act of 2008. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion's agreed to. The next bill is H.R. 3548, the Plain Language and Government Communications Act, and without objection, this bill will be considered as read and open to amendment at any point. It will require federal agencies to write documents related to a service or a benefit in plain language, and I appreciate Mr. Braley's leadership on this bill. Government documents should be clearly written and easy to understand. I think we can all agree that older Americans should be able to understand letters they receive about their Social Security benefits. Veterans should be able to easily understand information from the Department of Veterans Affairs and how to take advantage of the GI Bill. The amendment Mr. Braley plans to offer will include several improvements to the bill, including several changes that were suggested by Mr. Sally. I believe the Braley amendments will strengthen the bill, and we'll say more on that when the amendment is offered. Mr. Braley, I want to yield to you to speak on the bill, opening statement on the bill before we get to amendments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a written statement at the desk, and I would ask unanimous consent that it be incorporated.
Without objection, the full statement will be in the record.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Davis, this has been a passion of mine for about 25 years, ever since I was admitted to practice law in the state of Iowa. The Iowa Supreme Court had just adopted plain language drafting requirements for jury instructions that were used to communicate legal obligations to jurors in cases all across the state of Iowa. And as a result of that, a passion was born in me to try to help move government to a more effective ways of communicating with its intended audience. There are countless examples of individual citizens who have been cut out of an ability to understand their responsibilities and their relationship with the federal government because of complex and unclear communications that come forth from federal agencies. And so that's why I'm very, very pleased to offer this bill. As the chair of the Contracting and Technology Subcommittee of the Small Business Committee, we recently had a hearing on this very topic to give small business owners and federal agencies a chance to talk about the significant improvements that have been made in agencies like the Securities and Exchange Commission, who have actually implemented plain language requirements on how they communicate. And the chair of the head of the agency, Christopher Cox, came and spoke about the tremendous savings of taxpayer dollars and staff hours in responding to concerns from constituents who don't understand the complex requirements that the federal government imposes. I'm also very pleased to work with my friend, Mr. Sally, to improve this bill and the amendment that I'll be offering later, and appreciate his commitment to doing everything that we can to help consumers, taxpayers, small business owners, and others who interact with the federal government find a way to do that in a more effective and efficient manner. And I will look forward to working with the rest of the committee as this bill moves forward and urge its adoption.
Thank you very much, Mr. Braley. Any further opening statements?
Mr. Chairman, may I?
Oh, yes. Recognize the chairman of the subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to also join with my friend and colleague, Mr. Braley, in urging passage of the Plain Language and Government Communications Act. Over the past two decades, the federal government has undertaken numerous initiatives intended to make government more effective while also making its programs more effective and efficient. One critical task was to ensure that our taxpayer-funded programs and services became more user-friendly by producing public information about programs that is easy to understand and widely accessible to all citizens. The legislation before us today will help meet this goal by requiring federal agencies to use plain language in all government documents related to obtaining a government-provided service or benefit. This bill meets this goal by establishing a sensible definition of what is plain language, while providing clear reporting guidelines for agencies to demonstrate compliance to Congress in a timely manner. In short, this bill is a well-crafted and sensible measure that will build on past efforts to make agency programs more accessible and transparent for everyone, and I urge my colleagues to adopt the bill. I yield back.
Thank you very much.
Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Davis.
Let me just say, I want to thank the author of this legislation. In President Clinton's 1998 memo on using plain language in government documents, he stated, plain language requirements vary from one document to another, depending on the intended audience. Plain language documents have logical organization, easy-to-read design features, and use common everyday words, except for necessary technical terms, you and other pronouns, the active voice, and short sentences. Writing in plain language doesn't mean writing only about simple things. It means writing well about anything the government does. And I want to applaud the author of this legislation. My understanding is that Mr. Sally has also been working with the majority to require plain language be used in preparing collection of information, primarily tax documents, as well as regulations issued by federal agencies. And I also support him and appreciate his efforts in this regard. But I support the legislation and look forward to bring this to the floor as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any further opening statements? If not, are there amendments to the proposal?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at
Mr.
the desk.
Mr. Bailey has an amendment at the desk. Without objection, it will be considered as read, and gentleman is recognized to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And as you indicated in your opening remarks, this amendment reflects input from Mr. Sally, from the chairman's input, and I think it strengthens and improves the bill. And let me just briefly go over the changes to the original bill. On page 3 at line 5, there is the addition of language to reflect the fact that the Comptroller General will be responsible for looking into the implementation of these plain language guidelines and also making recommendations on how to improve them within a fixed period of time. So that language is added as part of the overall discussion of how the plain language will be implemented. The second change is in the definition of covered documents. It reflects the input from Mr. Sally. By adding the word or file taxes and also or filing taxes, it also clarifies that this applies whether in a paper or an electronic form, and it also requires agencies to use plain language in the collection of any information, and I sincerely appreciate his input into that particular portion of the bill. The next change is on line 12, and it again clarifies the role of the Comptroller General after the report is issued to update and incorporate the recommendations of the existing plain language guidelines. The next change also reflects the input from Mr. Sally. On page 4 after line 6, it adds new language requiring agencies to use to the extent practicable and appropriate plain language and regulations promulgated by the agency, which I also encourage everyone to support. And then the next change is on page 4, striking line 7 through 15, and replacing the reporting requirement, simply adding the following additional language that requires the report of each agency to deal with the compliance with this act and the agency's continued efforts to meet the objectives that we set forth in subsection A. And then the final change is on page 4 after line 15, requiring the evaluation and report by the Comptroller General within 6 months after the date of the enactment, including recommendations on plain language guidelines and best practices for plain language. I think all of these changes are positive and help move us in the direction that we all want to go in, and I would encourage the amendment's passage.
Thank you, Mr. Braley. Any further discussion of the Braley amendment? Mr. Selling?
Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Chairman Waxman, Ranking Member Davis. James Madison wrote in the Federalist Paper number 62 that, quote, it will be of little avail to the people that the laws are made by men of their own choice if the laws are so voluminous that they cannot be read or so incoherent that they cannot be understood. While I recognize that we are yet adding to the volume of statutes, today this committee is addressing a common sense measure, one dedicated to James Madison's proposition that the laws governing us should be readily understood. When the government requires citizens to comply with rules or information requests, often under penalty of law, Americans deserve to have that requirement stated in plain language. The bill before us today is an important step in that direction. While it is not comprehensive, I am pleased to see the modest additions to the bill before us today, including tax forms and instructions. The Plain Language and Government Communications Act will enhance citizen access to government information and services by promoting the use of plain language in government documents issued to the public. When the Subcommittee on Information Policy, Census, and National Archives addressed this bill in January, I raised concerns that the bill only focused on documents relating to benefits or services. Since that time, Mr. Braley and I and our staff have been working together to find ways to expand the scope of the bill to include links the tax forms, instructions, surveys, and other similar types of documents. And I'd like to thank you, Mr. Braley, for working with me on this. Every year, millions of Americans fill out form after form to comply with the law. The OMB estimates that the total paperwork burden imposed on Americans to comply with federal information requirements in 2005 was 8.4 billion hours, averaging a burden of roughly 28 hours per person annually. The most familiar example of types of forms constituting this burden are tax forms, of course, which do account for 80% of the total paperwork burden. It's important to notice that the documents we are discussing represent a legal obligation to report information to the government, usually under penalty of law, and it is imperative that Americans know just what is being asked of them, and that is why plain language and tax forms, instructions, all federal government requests that constitute a collection of information is so important. The additions made to the bill today advance that effort. Unfortunately, the language does not include tax forms. Fortunately, the language does include tax forms. Notably missing from today's discussion is a plain language requirement for rules and regulations of agencies. The cost of complying with federal regulations for small businesses that have fewer than 20 employees is about $7,600 per employee. Small businesses operate typically on a narrow margin to begin with. I again assert today that nearly $8,000 per employee in regulatory compliance costs is just unacceptable. Ensuring that individuals, small businesses, and other entities readily can ascertain what the federal government is requiring should be central to the way the United States government does business. The American people will benefit the most by having an efficient government that communicates with plain, easy-to-understand language. In a hearing on the same topic, in the last Congress, Dr. Annetta Cheek, Vice Chair of the Center for Plain Language, stated it best saying, and I'm quoting, "A veteran who needs medical help will be able to understand what she needs to do. A small business owner will be able to claim tax benefits and other considerations to which he is entitled. A school wanting to comply with No Child Left Behind Act will be able to figure out what to do without reading the regulation five times. A senior citizen or hospital or pharmacy will be able to understand immediately what Medicare or drug benefits apply." I am pleased to see the modest additions included in this language. I do believe this committee is missing a significant opportunity to lessen the burden of government on small businesses and taxpayers by not including rules and regulations, but I intend to vote in favor of this measure and note for the record that I hope the chairman will work with me and other members of the committee to address these issues and expand the scope of this legislation or similar legislation as this issue moves forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Solly. Any further discussion of the Braley Amendment? If not,
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Ms. Fox.
I'm prepared to offer an amendment. Do you want to adopt this first?
Yeah, let's dispose of this amendment, then we'll consider your amendment. All those in favor of the Braley Amendment will say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendment's agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill, Mrs. Fox?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend Mr. Braley.
Oh, let me call it forward, ask that without objection be considered as read, and generally is recognized to explain our amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend Mr. Braley also for bringing this forward. From the time I served in state government, I thought that we should have one person in each agency who was designated to look at every document coming out of every agency and make sure that it was written in language that the average citizen could understand. And I, like Mr. Sally, would like to go a lot further with this and include rules and regulations and anything that's coming out of the federal government. But then we'd have to find people who could write it and look over the material, which might be a challenge to us. But I want to add an amendment that I think will make this very good bill even a little bit better, and it would ask that to the maximum extent practicable, we preserve and enhance the role of English by using the English language in all covered documents. That's a part of the amendment. It's been very, very carefully crafted to avoid any possible objections that it might restrict the availability of foreign language documents. I realize there are possibilities that we will do that. But my hope is that we'll improve again the government's effectiveness and accountability by promoting clear communication the public can understand and use. And I think one way of doing that is to highlight the importance of the English language, because it is a unifying language for our country, and my hope is that it will ensure consistency and clarity in our government documents. So I would ask for your support on this, and I think it strengthens the bill.
We have before us the Fox Amendment. Any further discussion of that amendment? Mr. Braley?
Would the gentlewoman yield for a question?
I will, and if you'd let me make one other quick comment I meant to make. We didn't think about this until yesterday, and I apologize for that. If we had, we would have come to you earlier to include it in your manager's amendment. And I want to tell you, seriously, we worked on this last night when we knew we were coming into this committee. So I meant to say that at the beginning, and I apologize.
The question I have is based upon 24 years of looking at statutory construction after the fact and trying to get a clear understanding from you of what your intent is with the first portion of the amendment, and specifically what you mean by shall to the maximum extent practicable. Because I can foresee situations where requiring all covered documents to be written in the English language could literally lead to a life and death situation, since some of the documents we're talking about are ways that the federal government communicates with patients through the Veterans Administration and also through people who are coming to medical facilities and in need of care and are going to depend upon these documents in order to communicate information which literally could lead to a life or death situation. So I guess the point I'm trying to clarify is when you say to the maximum extent practicable, do you recognize there are situations where using English as the only language of communication is not in the best interest of achieving this objective?
Oh, absolutely. And that's why I say down below that nothing shall be construed to prohibit the use of a language other than English. So if you see that's there,
yes.
That's why I wanted to make it abundantly clear that we weren't doing that.
Thank you.
May I ask Ms. Fox, since this only came up yesterday, I have no problem with it saying that we ought to use English, not prohibiting other languages where it's necessary, But this is a non-controversial bill, and I would like us to be sure we don't enter into some controversy. Would you be willing to continue to talk about this as we go to the floor, and I can then check with others to be sure we're not going to engender support, and we clarify. Some people raise with me, what does it mean in all covered documents? What does that?
That means the documents covered by this bill.
Mr. Chairman, I just note there is a provision here that says nothing in this act shall be construed to prohibit the use of a language other than English.
Yeah.
And that they're particularly for Native Alaskans and Native Americans and those kind of issues, or to disparage any language or discourage from learning. It would be helpful if we can try to work this to make sure it doesn't create an unneeded controversy. But I think the intent of this is a good intent.
Let me make this suggestion. This is the kind of bill that would go on the suspension calendar. It's so non-controversial. I don't consider your amendment offensive in any way. I don't see that it's going to be controversial, but I know that just saying English only is controversial.
It doesn't say English only, Mr. Chairman.
No, but people start reading these things.
We may have a problem with plain language, too, in the bill. If people start doing that, I've thought about that. How are we going to define plain language? But
yeah. Let me suggest this to the members, that we adopt this amendment with the understanding that we're going to perhaps revisit the issue if we need to clarify it in plain English further to be sure that we're not raising some controversy that might not otherwise have been foreseen. Is that acceptable to the author of the legislation, Mr. Braley?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
And it's very acceptable to me, Mr. Chairman, because if we can write it better, certainly in this bill, we should do that. We should practice what we preach.
Well, we should write it in plain. Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. Well, then, vote, without objection, we'll accept the Fox Amendment. Anybody object to the unanimous consent request? If not, that's been agreed to. Any further amendments to the bill? If not, the vote now comes on passing the H.R. 3548 as amended. All those in favor of the motion will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion's agreed to. We have a vote or votes on the House floor, and we still have some naming legislation, post office naming resolution, and other resolutions. Let's break to vote on the House floor and then return, and we'll reconvene the meeting after the last vote. So we stand in recess until.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think we could do these small bills very, very quickly.
That's fine with me, but there are some amendments to them.
I think we can do those quickly, too. Let's see how fast and how. So we don't have to come back.
Okay. Give me the list. Okay. I'd like to ask that the following proposals be considered en bloc. H.R. 4185, Representative Hilda Solis designating U.S. Postal Service after Specialist Marisol Heredia, H.R. 5395 by Russ Carnahan, Post Office to be named after Congressman William Bill Clay, H.R. 5472, introduced by Peter Versklosky, designates a postal facility in Indianapolis after late Congresswoman Judith Carson, H.R. 5479, introduced by Representative Vernon Ellers, U.S. Postal Facility in Ionia after Alonzo Woodruff, H.R. 5483, H.R. 5489, H.R. 5517, H.R. 5528, these are all postal naming bills, as well as H.Con. Res. 310 by Elijah Cummings, H.Res. 952 by Ron Klein. These are all non-controversial, and we will.
I urge their adoption, Mr. Chairman.
We will make available in the record and to anybody who's covering this hearing the specifics of what these bills are. There were.
You could just draw a block with it. Let's go with my amendment. We are doing
Okay. And so on those proposals to be considered en bloc, is there any objection to reporting them all out en bloc? If not, that will be the action of the committee. We have six resolutions that require amendments. We have seven now? Okay, we have seven resolutions that require amendments. Let me call them all up to be considered en bloc. H.R.S. 578, National Watermelon Month. H.R.S. 886, regarding tragic acts of violence in Colorado Springs and Arvada, Colorado. And there's a technical amendment by Mr. Davis, and without objection, that amendment will be incorporated in the en bloc proposal. H.R.S. 892, express support for the designation of March 11, 2008 as the National Funeral Director and Mortician Recognition Act. There's a technical amendment that will be adopted without objection. H.R.S. 994, to support the designation of National Glansman's Thrombostenia Awareness Day, a technical amendment by Mr. Davis, which will be agreed to without objection. H.R.S. 1005, express support for the goals and ideals of Borderline Personality Awareness Month, and without objection, a technical amendment by Mr. Davis will be added to that. H.R.S. 1021, expressing support for the goals, ideals, and history of the National Women's History Month. Without objection, a technical amendment by the chairman will be incorporated in that. And then H.R.S. 1016, expressing condolences on the death of William F. Buckley, with an amendment by Mr. Davis without objection, will be considered to that proposal. All of these seven resolutions are before us to be considered in block as amended. All those in favor of reporting them all out will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the motion is agreed to, and that completes the business of our committee. Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thanks for the patience of all the members in allowing us to consider all the bills before us, and we stand adjourned.